All right. Well, joining us tonight, Dr. Julio Tihanqui of the De La Salle University College of Liberal Arts, and also still with us here in the studio, USD Professor Edmund Tayo. Well, thank you very much, Professor Tihanqui, for joining us tonight.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Now, let me see your fingers. All right.
Oh, yeah.
I guess, yeah.
I'm
the only one in here, so mm-hmm. I can always say that I am in good company. Even the information director of the COMELEC could not vote because he was also delisted.
Duty first.
Yeah. All right. Of course, Director That's James Jimenez, was, he's also very candid about why he was delisted. Well, in any case, we were already talking about how the issue of political dynasties may or may not have even influenced how voters looked at the choices out there, either from Team Pinoy, from UNA, or the entire roster of independents. Now, dynasties, as we've seen them evolve in Philippine politics, have either been derided for what they stand for or admired because of what they've done for their constituents. In the present milieu, are political dynasties still seen as a malignant factor in politics or as a benign issue in politics?
Well, yes, of late, dynasty has become the in issue, particularly in this campaign, together with the anti-Apple drive. No? But we should understand the phenomenon of political dynasties in its proper perspective. Of course, some would argue that in other countries, dynasties do exist, even in advanced Western democratic countries. But personally, in a developing country or in a developing society such as ours, dynasty becomes an issue because it is directly related with the concept of public power. Mm-hmm. And for example, in economics, whenever you have a monopoly or a cartel, that is considered a market failure. In the same manner, in a democracy like ours, whenever there is lack of competition, wherever there is a concentration of power in the hands of a few elites, particularly a few political families, then we can say that there is a failure in the political system. Mm-hmm.
And who do we trace that failure to? Is it because of a lack of discernment among the voters themselves, or is it because there is a lack of controlling mechanisms to prevent those dynasties from taking root?
Of course, first and foremost, it's a product of history. It's the way our institutions have been set up. It's the way our systems have evolved through time. And we've heard a lot of politicians say that their family is not a dynasty, but rather they're just following a legacy. But then again, in some instances, that may be true. But then again, the problem here is it's not a question of personalities. It's not a question of good or bad families. Mm-hmm. It's a question of good or bad systems.
Yeah.
And what we have is a very bad system in which there is already a tightening or a it's like when you eat too much cholesterol, it clogs your arteries. Mm-hmm. No? And if the pathway towards political power, if the pathway towards legislative power is clogged by members of the same political class, by members of the same dynasty, then we have a problem.
Let me just ask Professor Tayo the same question. Do what we have now, this whole issue of political dynasties, is this a function of that particular family, any political family, or a function of a lack of a strong party system?
Well, that's one. That could have been the first step, at least for some of those that had been trying to come up with ways by which to counteract these limitations of our democratic system. But again, as I've mentioned, sadly, this did not go through. And I tend to agree with Dr. Tihangki when he says that this is a product of history, but I would go further by saying it's because of the socioeconomic structure that we have, which is, of course, the product of history. Mm-hmm. But going again further, as far as political systems are concerned, we barely actually have institutions that are working. In other words, institutions, the way we know it, would be institutions by way of name. In other words, if we look at the executive branch of government or the legislature for that matter, it would all depend on who is the incumbent. It's not about continuity. For example, if we talk about the same program of PPP.
Right.
PPP is the same as build, operate, transfer mm-hmm. before, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And of course, in some other departments, I might have to say that even some health programs would be similar, if not exactly the same, as the previous administration. But just so that you want to put a different name to it and claim that this is yours, you come up with a different name. But in other setup, precisely because the system more or less suggests that it is the institution that acted on the program, you have to proceed with the same program. Probably there may be some changes in terms of, say, budgeting or approach in terms of implementation, but it's not necessarily something that you will simply do away with, change the name, just so that you can discredit another. So this is the problem. In other words, again, to me, it's not political culture. This is systemic, and definitely, if you clog the system, you have to do some way by which you unclog the system. And because you say unclog the system, that means you do something with the existing system.
Okay, I wanted to go back to that point. I mean, if it's a fault or a flaw in the system, and we need to declog that system, was there any hope at all in doing so by passing a law mm-hmm. in Congress banning political dynasties? Okay. I mean, the Constitution, of course, says it's there, but you don't have the implementing law.
Okay. To my mind, there are three factors why we continue to suffer from the dominance of political clans and political dynasties. The first is the failure of political recruitment, particularly at the local level.
Okay.
And that is where what Professor Tayo was saying, the problem of the socioeconomic structure. There is a high bar for any newcomer to enter the game. Moreover, the rules of the game is biased against any new entrants. So that is the very first problem, the very first hurdle. The quality of our democracy largely depends on how actively involved our citizens are. And if our citizens themselves cannot enter the game, then we have a big problem. So that is the very first thing that we should take into consideration. We should promote active citizenship. In some instances, the problem is even with most of the dynasties, as was shown by the film clip, belongs to the old elites, the old clans. So around 60% of these dynasties, these clans, are from the old elites, usually from traditional landowners. Mm. But there is a growing percentage of non-traditional elites from the professional sector, around 40%+. Professional sector, the middle class, OFW, all of these are the new middle class, the new constituency.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is, if a minority of this new, non-traditional elites, new middle class, get elected into office, after they reach their term limit, guess what they will do?
They'll pass it on to some other member of the family.
They'll start their own dynasty. And we have seen that even with our Pambansang Kamao.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. He belongs to a non-traditional background, and he leveraged on his success as a sports hero for his political career. And now he's starting his own dynasty in Gensai. So that's the problem. The second would be, again, the weakness of our party system. If you will look at all the parties that have become dominant, let's leave the pre-martial law era. Let's leave the Marcos era. Let's just focus on the post-Marcos, post-EDSA political period. If you look at all the dominant parties, you will see that no single dominant political party would continue with its strength and dominance after the incumbency of a particular president. Mm-hmm. So, for example, after Marcos, you had KBL. Then after KBL, you have CORI, LDP. Then President Ramos, Lacaz. Then President Estrada, LAMP. Then GMA, Campi. And now we have the Liberal Party back in power. But the problem is, if you look at the names of the members of all of this, it's the same name over and over. Exactly. So, which leads us to the next problem, which is party switching.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, one way to sort of dilute the power from the top and from the elitist circle out into the people was the partyless system. That could have helped craft laws to favor the marginalized and underrepresented, just in case, you know, members of the political dynasties just craft laws for themselves. But how's that going for us so far, Professor Tayo?
Well, the party list system is another piece of experimentation that we need to revisit. As I've mentioned earlier, it's one of those institutional reforms that require a very serious rethinking. But sadly, again, this was not considered. It's not in the list of priorities of the administration. You see, in our existing political dynamics, unless a piece of legislation is made a priority by the administration, it will not have any good chance at all getting through at least second reading. I mean, for example, the Political Party Reform Act supposedly enjoyed substantial support in both houses of Congress. If I'm not mistaken, and I shared some thoughts with some members of the House of Representatives, it got through the House of Representatives, but in the Senate, it managed to get to the second reading, and then suddenly there was an effort to get rid of it. And so we still don't have a political party reform law. In the case of the party list law, you know, I'm not sure whether this is a flaw in the Constitution, but definitely there's something wrong with how we implement it. The way I understand it is because the way I understand it is the intent is to introduce a way of proportional representation in our political system. When we say PR system, that means from a geographic system of representation, you do sectoral representation, which means that in 3rd district or 2nd district of what, Quezon City, Caloocan, or Manila, you will have a good mix of teachers or professionals and elites, business people, young, and so on and so forth. But the way you represent in the system of party list, you do it by sector. So youth, labor, if there's a farmer, that's the way it is designed to be. Interestingly, from the Panganiban rule, which significantly altered, legislated another party list system, in other words, coming up with a new formula, now you have another Supreme Court rule saying that, you know, any political party can take can participate in
this. That it's not exclusive to sectoral representation.
It's not exclusive to sectoral representation. If that's the case, then we might as well just, you know, put everyone in a list system of representation, not the plurality system.
Well, actually, both Professor Tayo and I are political scientists, so we more or less understand the root of the problem in the party list system. I think, to my mind, the root is actually the definition. I beg to disagree with Professor Tayo that the party list system is supposed to be a sectoral representation system of election. I beg to disagree. Because if you will look back at the debates in the Constitutional Commission with those who introduced the provision, there is already a confusion between sectoral representation and proportional representation. These are two different concepts. Sectoral representation is you allot seats for sectors as reserved seats. And then you have proportional representation, which is practiced largely in parliamentary forms of government, in which it is the manner by which each vote is converted into seats. So unlike in the presidential form of system, presidential system of governance, you have the single seat. We elect by plurality, whoever wins by majority wins it all. It's the winner takes it all system of election. In the proportional representation, you look at the total percentage of votes a particular party garners in an election. Mm-hmm. Then you are allotted seats in proportion to the total number of votes cast for the entire election.
Okay.
Now, the confusion arose when they merged the two concepts, sectoral and proportional representation, into a hybrid partyless system that's now functioning in our country for the past electoral cycle.
I was talking to former Comelec Commissioner Rene Sarmiento about that because he was a member of the Constitutional Commission that crafted that.
Yes.
And he did say this is, you know, partyless system, Philippine style. I'm not sure if it's good or bad, but apparently from what you're saying.
So more or less, the latest decision by the Supreme Court, I believe, is in the right track. But that doesn't mean that we should not review the very nature of having a partyless system. And I think there is a social justice component to it. And it has provided an alternative avenue for non-traditional elites to enter the halls of Congress. Mm. So it's just a matter of fixing it up. But I believe, personally, we should look into the party reform bill first before we revisit the Party Development Act. And from what I heard, Edmond, it will be part of the second round of reform package that this administration will push,
I hope,
in Congress.
Because, so, you know, during the time of FBR, this is a part of an entire package.
Yes.
But precisely because it's difficult to get through Congress, that they chopped it into pieces.
And which leads me to the point regarding institutional barriers to prevent dynasties. The very first institutional barrier that was put in place was the term limits.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, and this is the subject of my doctoral dissertation, when the term limits was first implemented in the 11th Congress, and this was the batch of then Congressman Noynoy, Congressman Chisos Cadenhol, the problem was when the term limits was implemented, there was no anti-dynasty law. It should have gone
hand in hand.
Because you put a term limit,
papahinga lang.
Nothing prevented the dynasties from passing it on to their next of kin.
So papahinga lang.
So if you put an anti-dynasty law together with the Party Reform Act on top of term limits, then perhaps we can.
Well, actually, you see the kind of vagueness that we have in the kind of laws that we use to restrict politicians from actually seeking different terms. When you have an ex-president who actually runs for the presidency again but loses and then decides he can run for mayor this time around. I mean, where does it actually end? I mean, as a politician, you can just shift from one role to the other, but there's no real limit as to how many chances you get to run for public office.
Well, it's always open to interpretation. You know, that's why lawyers and even social scientists like us, you know, will take so much amount of time for us to debate. I mean, for example, there are so many ways of interpreting how to go about doing things. But the bottom line here is, again, how the work of numbers or the requirement of numbers would have to be approached by the administration to get things done. So that's how I see things. Because, again, the issue of systems and objective, to me, the objective is the sectoral representation. The means would be the proportional system.
Mm-hmm.
So the confusion is simply because they might have confused with the terms. So I agree to that when you say plurality system, we do a single member plurality system. Ito yung technical term when we say that regardless of how many candidates you have, you only declare as winner the one who gets the most number of votes.
Mm-hmm.
But when you say PR, maraming formula yon, no? And it can be a single transferable vote and so on and so forth. Now, the point here is that when we look at systems, it must be able to zero in on the issue. If we want to get rid of political dynasties, if we want to expand the system of representation, then we have to have a clear set of rules, not to prohibit, but to make sure that a system actually works.
Well, clearly the system that we have now that governs the party, the system here, has yet to maximize its potential, correct? And we still have to revisit it, as you said. But what about the laws that have come from these partyless groups who were able to successfully enter the halls of Congress? Anything you could say about that? Impressive, not impressive? What's the grade so far?
To me, sa akin, impressive naman. But may baggage pa din to me. I mean, for example, I am impressed with the performance of the militant partyless groups. Still, the lingering question to me is why up to now they have yet to publicly disassociate themselves with the Communist Party or with the, at least, at the very least, the New People's Army that, you know, keeps on doing something else in the countryside. So, in other words, here you are participating in the parliamentary process, but there's another group affiliated with you, supposedly, or probably you, the both groups support each other. And, you know, you gain from that association. So, you go to the countryside, you're able to campaign there free from harm, free from collecting any fee for what have you. But the other political groups simply cannot campaign without having to work with the parameters set by the group. So in terms of participation, in terms of performance, yes, good. But yun nga, merong kulang eh para sa akin.
And now let's talk about the other faction. Some people are saying, you know, why even run? Why even ask for the people's votes when the party list itself, this particular party list, is well entrenched in the executive via cabinet secretaries or undersecretaries? Do they even need representation in Congress when they're in Malacanang practically?
That's a very narrow interpretation of sectoral representation and party list system. So does that mean if Bayan Muna wins the, you know, if Teddy Casino wins in the Senate, does that mean that's already cause for dismantling Bayan Muna as a partyless system? So yeah, that's a very, you know, it doesn't stand on solid ground, that kind of argument. So we're looking at parties, and the role of parties is to get into government, actually. The role of parties in a functioning democracy is to win elections in order to enter into a coalition with the ruling party.
So that they can maybe institutionalize reforms or changes through the laws
from
that
within.
They craft, yes, from within, even after any particular administration, even after that particular administration,
yes.
Correct? Right. Okay, so we're going to have to say goodbye to Dr. Julio Tihanqui. We appreciate you joining us
Thank
here
you.
On
Thank
the
you.
Panel. Thanks again, Tony.